it became really clear, well, basically, that if there is an expansive and a contractive part of the universe, the expansion part is what we see as reality, which is the radiating electromagnetic emission that we see. A star, a planet, an atom, all radiate energy. That's why we see it, right? And the contractive part that we don't see would be the vacuum energy curving, space-time curving into it, generating singularity, generating the gravitational field. So now I had an inkling about the relationship between electromagnetism, radiation, and gravity.
Gravity goes into the singularity.
Gravity going towards singularity. Space-time curving towards singularity. If things are expanding from a point, from a center, then they must be expanding radially. It must make the geometry of a sphere. Right? The expansive part being the geometry of a sphere. That's what we see. A sun, a planet, a galaxy. Galaxies have galactic halos that are perfect spheres around them. Atoms, cells, whatever. Spheres. So we see the sphere part because that's the expansion part. But what I wanted to know about was the contractive structure of the vacuum. Why did I want to know about that? Because if I understood the structure of the contractive part of the vacuum, then I understood the geometry of the foundation of creation. That holds to the center is the primary force from which the illusionary radiation occurs. The smallest volume, the volume that's collapsing, and that is a tetrahedron. This graphic, this is not my graphic, this graphic was on the page. A tetrahedron within a sphere. Was the result of a paper that had been published by an American engineer that had been hired to survey the huge city, ancient city of Teotihuacan near Mexico City. This is where there's the moon pyramid and the sun pyramid and the way of the dead and all this stuff. His name was Hugh Holliston Jr. And the paper was published by the American Earth Society after 20 years of him putting, surveying all of the buildings there. Well, when Hugh Holliston Jr. started to survey the buildings at that ancient city, he found something very bizarre. He found that all the buildings there seems to, like the large buildings, the temples and such, seems to be in the exact appropriate place to describe all the orbits of our solar system, with the sun pyramid, the moon pyramid, and everything. He found all the orbits, including Pluto and Neptune. And he found that there was some incredible mathematical recurrence in all of the measurements that he was taking. And that recurrence, these mathematics that kept on creeping up, were always the same. And he figured out that they were pointing out to the mathematics of a sphere and a tetrahedron embedded in it. The isotropic vector metric from Buckminster Fuller. He said that the mathematical constant that he got from his surveying of that ancient city pointed out to the square root of 9/8, which is the mathematical constant for an isotropic vector metric generated by Buckminster Fuller.
Since I took karate class, I've been noticing about the geometry and the ratios on fingers, and then I had a dream a couple weeks ago, and I was looking at my hands, and they converge, like, I know they converge to infinity or something like that, and then I noticed it was related to this crop circle of, reminds me of Solomon's temple, and it's possibly the sphere and square and a circle and the geometry of infinity, I think.
Thank you. always looked at as two-dimensional. So if you've got a wing, for instance, let's say that's a wing, you're looking at the flow going over the top and under the bottom. You're not looking at the flow going this way. So everything in nature has three dimensions. Most of our science is really dealing with two dimensions, and most of our tools are as well. So you can see the spiral here in the end. That's a pretty familiar spiral you see in your whirlpool. And that's easily understood, but it's two dimensions. It's this dimension and this dimension. But look, we've got a third dimension. And you can see it's changing in the third dimension. That's very complicated. I mean, it's infinitely complicated. If you think about it, every living thing goes through a liquid phase in its development. So it takes on the geometry of turbulence. So every living thing on Earth has these geometries built into it, from the cochlea of your ear to the spacing between your teeth, the size of your teeth, to even if I look at my finger, the length of that in proportion to that bone and in proportion to that bone are the same proportions that you find in these spirals. So it's everywhere.
Thank you. Thank you. what we found from that, and we come to the conclusion that with the complex interaction of the magnetostatic and piezoelectric effects in the materials which consists of, in the materials from which a pyramid consists of,